the output has become a standard practice. Okay, so that will be a way to prove it. They never asked, and by default, we got machine translation. Okay, and then it's your decision to do something about it, depending on the quality, of course. And again, remember, this has nothing to do with Google Translate or Microsoft. It's their own empty engines, which might be perfect for some language pairs, or might be, as for example, Croatian team was complaining a little bit, even on things that they shouldn't have. For example, you said that your output is somehow polluted with
serial.
Definitely, let's link it with Martin classes. What's the reason for those Cyrillic characters in your Croatian output?
Someone probably used them before.
Someone used it before, or we can make, at some point in our translation memory, in our translation model, the parallel data we have, there was some crap there, mixing stuff. And remember, this is just lines of characters for the machine. There is no real knowledge there in terms of this is Croatian language.
And probably they put in the same basket all Slavic languages, so if there is no appropriate word, they just take the other.
Exactly. And actually, this is a good case for one of the exercises we will do. Human translation or human translator should be involved in an ideal world in the building or in the process of building the language model for any MTA engine, just to make sure that it's the right text, the right combination, clean data, and so on and so forth. Okay, because otherwise we get outputs that could be easily improved if we work on the translation model before, meaning providing clean data. Okay, so that was something that I wanted to say. Something that I'm going to say, regardless of you want to post edit or not, I'm going to show you the post editing guidelines that you will get from Microsoft if they ask you to post edit following full post editing guidelines. Now you know an estimation of what is expected from you. And remember, go back to the PowerPoint if you want like a more detailed explanation of should I change spelling, yes or no? Should I change terminology, yes or no? All of that you check in that PowerPoint. But now I'm going to show you what normally Microsoft shares with their translators when they need to post-edit machine translation. And here you will see that it's more like behavioral guidelines. Okay, they are not telling me, be careful with punctuation. They don't tell me, terminology is key or is super important. Look what they tell you. Basically, they are training from the behavioral point of view how to go about with post-editing tasks. And they use this 5-10-second evaluation rule. We said in the definition of post-editing that it should be done in as few edits as possible. Okay? We need to be fast. Okay? So they ask, 15 seconds should be the maximum time that you should spend evaluating the validity of the empty suggestion. We need to be fast with it. As a human translator, that's one of your skills. You should be good at reading, right? If it is hard to understand at the beginning, you know, you start reading your sentence, 5-10 seconds, do not read the whole sentence. Ignore. Proceed to translate from scratch instead. This could be tricky because maybe there was some benefit at the end of the segment, but in principle, just to give you an overview of how they will go about post-editing, evaluate 5-10 seconds, okay? Is it worth, and then your human brain, as a human translator, would say, there is something to benefit from here, or just start working from scratch, okay? High five and low five mode. When you detect a long sentence, there will be segments that are really short, so that's really easy to say yes, no. I'm going for post-editing or I'm just ignoring it. Confronted with long sentences, they ask you to read the 5 words at the beginning of the sentence. If it's good, read on until it's bad. Then stop and copy the correct part and continue to translate it and forget about the reading of. Meaning, use those 5 first words to evaluate, is it worth or is it not worth? Of course, there is training here. The more you post edit, the more you get acquainted to this. And there will be a point where you don't, maybe you spot mistakes from the end of your sentence, and you decide not to go about post editing. That's part of your training. In the same way that, as a human translator, you start probably being too focused on the sentence level, and then you get like a broad picture of the text. This is something that can be also learned in post editing tasks, how to evaluate. If the first 5 or 6 words are good, skip to read, and then they send you to the end of the segment. Read at the end, and depending on if the last part of the phrase is correct, phrase meaning last part of the sentence, phrase in the linguistic sense, use it without discarding the whole segment. Basically, check if there is something to benefit at the end, if it's a long sentence. If both the first and the last 5 words are incorrect, do not carry on reading through the middle of the segment and just discard the empty suggestion. Okay? This will be just an example, real, from Microsoft, in terms of behavioral guidelines, how to go about it. Okay? Try to put this together with what we said yesterday. And then, of course, it's a lot of practice. Go back to the workbench. We won't spend, a lot of time doing it, but just try to post edit 3 or 4 segments following these Microsoft guidelines I've just applied. First of all, here, for the first one, which was the heading, remember that this H is telling me you are post editing a heading, and maybe that has an influence. For example, in Spanish language, unlike English, we cannot use gerunds in headings. Or that would be a trace of saying, you're not a professional translator. Okay, so this is useful, and this will identify that, for example, the row empty output is an infinitive, and it could work. Ideally, being as a human translator, I would like to have a noun here, identificación. But this is good enough, okay? And this is how you go about. We've known Croatian, not great. SDL empty engines, not that perfect. Czech, you said, depending on the segment, some are okay. Is there any segments that is perfect from the beginning for Czech language? That you wouldn't make any edits there?
Some of them.
Okay, so that will be already a case from post editing. Is it the case for short segments or for long segments?
Short segments.
So it makes sense, right? Yeah. Longer sentences, things get messed up. For example, I can tell you from my Spanish side, it's true that there are some segments that are fine to click on Control Enter and approve them. Okay? So that was the aim of the exercise. Go home and keep on working with the workbench. The workbench, you will see that it doesn't have all the functionalities that you find in SDL Trados, the commercial version that people use to install in their machines. But it's more than perfect for showing empty outputs coming from this company. Okay? Any questions, any comments? Here, as it happened with Basecamp, remember that the way we go about will be to click on the segments that we give for final, or we decide that they are final, Control Enter, or we can do a question from Martin.
This is the first session, so maybe you have addressed this already. But is there a systematic difference in a translation editor, as you see here, and a post-editing editor? Well, would you say these are basically the same tools?
Nowadays, for professional translator, everything should be integrated.
Right. Meaning and that there's the no way. Particular functionality from the tool that supports post-editing rather than working with translation methods.
It's true that, for example, CrossLang used to have a workbench just for post-editing empty output. But the visuals will be exactly the same. Double column, at the left we have the source, at the right we have the target, and we go about it. Real world, tools that we use as professional translators, the same tool that I use for translating from scratch, for working with a translation memory, would be the same tool that I use used to input my machine translation.
Okay.
Okay. And actually, it makes sense because, I mean, we're working with language, and the workbench should integrate all the possible functionalities that we might be requested from the client. So if we don't tell anyone, and someone knocks on the door and opens and looks at this, without knowing the language here, you understand it, that person shouldn't know whether this is empty output or not, because the user interface is going to be the same.
But there are some operations that are much more typical for post-editing rather than working with translation errors. I would assume, for example, changing word order is much more likely when you do post-editing of empty output rather than if you have a suggestion from a translation memory where I think we exchange a word but not exchange the word order.
That's true.
So this kind of functionality where you maybe mark two words and say exchange or something like that, that is not specifically given anywhere.
That you have a very good research project if you want to develop up to, because the, for example, all the edits that we do, like copy, paste, move, that will depend on your skills, your keyword.
And that's general.
They will give you like extra functions thinking that in post-editing,
okay,
it's more about copy-pasting instead of rewriting,
yeah,
which we might need to test.
Okay.
Yeah? But the functionalities will be the same. Okay? It's true that maybe they could create new options here, say, swap words, or do this, do that, thinking in post-editing behavior. But that, I don't know of any specific functionalities thinking about post-editing behavior. Yes, more or less? Question.
Is it possible to recall the machine translation if you decided too fast to erase it and then you want to make it appear again?
Good question. In a more professional tool, there will be a way to retrieve, because here we will see a panel. If you have already an experience with CAD tools, here it always shows a panel giving you the raw empty output. And then you, by clicking here, it goes back here. In this tool, for instance, something that you can do, I will close the text, but probably you will lose part of your behavior, and I will pre-translate again, meaning I will create the task again.
Yeah, but this will take so much time.
Or you undo.
But that's a very good question. It doesn't happen in this workbench, but remember, for example, make CAD, the raw empty output always shows below, together with the TM matches, right? So clicking there, we will put the raw empty output back in place if we need to work back. It doesn't happen here. They don't show the raw empty output. It's there from the beginning for you to post edit. If for some reason you delete it, if it's the last action you did, try Control Z until it shows up. I'm not sure if it works, but that could be a way to go about. Is it okay? Cool. Just to make sure that we have an overview of all the exercises, let's move to exercise 4. And remember, go home and work on this. Exercise 4, remember everything is in our Moodle. Exercise 4, I'm going to introduce another post-editing workbench for free. Limitation, confidentiality. Remember, all of these tools are in the cloud. MedCAD people, they claim they don't do anything with our text, and we have the option to work with private translation memories where we store our post-edited segments. SDL Online Translation Editor, they don't say anything, but I'm sure that in the background, all of these texts that we post-edit, they want to benefit for their own MT engines. Don't you think that it's a perfect resource for them, that perfect post-editing text that you've created in Croatian, for them to improve their MT engine? Of course, it's parallel data for them. Yes.
It would be easy to sell the template as well.
You mean that it's an easy target?
Yeah.
And there were cases, for example, this text is written in Bulgarian, and then the translation was this text is Macedonian.
That's true.
So
I mean, but who wants to spend that? Yeah. It's easy, yeah, there are crazy people all over the world. So I might be feeding wrong inputs, that's true. Yeah, good point. But we want to think that people are more, they have better things to do, I guess. Okay, so third post-editing workbench. Everybody knows Google Translator, right? And we know the classical interface where we paste a text and we get the output. This is a little bit more advanced. I mean, it's not super advanced, but it's just to give you the possibility to know these workings. And I'm going to ask you to click on this link here. The link is not here. So let's just go to the browser, Chrome again, please, and click on translate google.com. I will put it back in the folder and then create the. Everybody knows this. This is a real dedicated posterity work page. No. This is machine translation. We can paste a text and we get an output. But we see, comparing the other work pages we've seen, we don't work at the segment level. There are no options to copy paste. There are no options for formatting. Okay? This is like the raw way to work with MT. But if you go down, you'll be down in the web page. You see here, now it's showing you Danish for me. Here it should say translator toolkit, something like that. Yes, click on there. Google Translator toolkit. And you get to this web page. How many of you have been here before? Okay, good. How satisfied were you?
Well, I tried it only in college, so I didn't really use it professionally, but I think it was okay.
It's okay, but actually I'm bringing you here just first aim, I want you to know that this exists. And second important aim, we will see that we can work with glossaries that have no impact on the MT output. So we can compare it then with exercise 5. Okay? And also, I bring you here because, of course, this is Google Translate. We have Czech, we have Serbian, we have all the languages here. Okay, so let's do the following. Let me introduce the exercise. Everybody's here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm assuming that everybody has a Google account somehow.
Yeah.
So this is how we can see this. Okay. And remember, confidentiality. We are giving our text to Google. This is something we cannot avoid. So this will be one of the reasons why we don't use this professionally. Okay, just for purposes of knowing that it exists and knowing that we can create glossaries or even translation memories, but we won't work with this now, that have no impact in the MT output as compared with exercise 5 that we will see. So going back to that folder, exercise 4, have a look at the source text. Again, something in the field of software localization. We won't have the time to post-edit, but we will assume that, for example, this needs light post-editing because it's one of those README files that gets automatically installed in your machine that is quite likely that you won't read. Although there will be also, depending on the client, time, money, of course, why not going for full post-editing. Okay, so this is our source text in the same file. And can you see that there is a subfolder called glossaries? Let's go in there. And we see different formats. Okay, yesterday we already worked with glossaries. But remember that for MakeCAD, they only accept Excel files. First column, source language. Second column, target language. And if you want, a third column with comments, with definitions for the terms, with context, whatever you want. In the case of Google Translator Toolkit, they don't work with Excel files as glossaries. They will ask you to work with CSV. CSV stands for?
Comma separated
value. Okay? In the end, it's this. It's just that the separation between between the different columns will be a comma or a semicolon. Okay, so this is ready for you. And I've said that this is a glossaries from Microsoft. Extra data that you have in that folder. Do we all know TBX format?
Mm-hmm.
TBX format is a standard for terminology. In the same way that we share translation memories with TMX, we share terminology resources with TBX. These glossaries you see here, they come from Microsoft Translate from Microsoft Linguistic Portal, which is a resource that you should know for your linguistic or language portal for your future. We won't be able to use TVX directly in Google Translator Toolkit, but keep it there for the rest of your tools where you can import TVX, because you have there all the terminology for your languages in the field of Microsoft products. And let me go back here. Everybody needs to know this portal. Okay? Microsoft Language Portal, not because we love Microsoft or not because we hate Microsoft, but they offer resources for your languages. And that will be terminology. Okay? How do you translate files into Croatian? Can you give me the translation on the fly? Datoteka. Is it the same equivalent you see in your Apple computer? You don't know.
I have a PC.
You have a PC. Okay, so it's Microsoft terminology. And maybe we are not translating from Microsoft, but why not, you know, looking up for possible equivalents there. Okay, so this is for you to bring home and have a look. You will see that in the same folder for the exercise, I also copied or downloaded the style guides that they use for your languages. If you're a translator for Microsoft into Croatian, you will need to read this. The way you address the
style guides are different products within Microsoft.
This will be the overall. But probably if that's have you translated from Microsoft, sometimes that's true that there will be specific needs, and then in your localization toolkit they will give you those specific. But as an overview, it's good to have this information. Okay. Also because yeah, I mean not many of you are or want to translate. In terms of you know making a living out of it, but this is useful information. Okay, just to give you a little bit of background on the files that you find here. Important ones: the source text and the glossaries. Okay, first thing I want you to do is go back to Google Translator Toolkit and let's upload a glossary. Even before we upload any source text and so on, let's upload a glossary. So click on glossaries. This is just to make sure that in your post-editing process or during the post-editing process, you take into account the right terms that you should edit or change if they don't match the empty output. Click on here and let's upload a glossary. Click on upload. And it says upload glossary. Remember, it will have to be a CSV file, the one you have in that folder. It's already prepared in there. I mean, it's not magic how to prepare those files. It's just that in order to save time, the CSV file is the one you need to upload. So click on File, the folder for the exercise 4, and let's upload a glossary, which should be exercise 4, glossaries, let's go for this one. I go for check. Remember, when we haven't decided yet if we go, we don't have the source text, but make sure that we match languages here. If you upload Czech, Croatian or Slovenian, don't worry if it's not any of your languages because we won't put time in post-editing, just to show the workbench. So go for any of these languages. Open, write a label for your glossary so you're able to identify it later. Here they say CSV file should contain translation from one language, blah blah blah. Have a look at it. We already know that the file is ready to be uploaded, so click on upload file. And we should have a glossary here. Refresh. There it is. Okay. Again, this is one of the reasons why I also prepared those CSV files. I put there four terms. Okay, because I didn't want to spend a lot of time waiting for the upload and so on. So it's a toy glossary, so to speak. So we all have a glossary here, right? If it doesn't show, click on refresh. and it should be there at some point. Let's go back to translations. And this will be the translation value. Go to active. And if you haven't used this tool before, nothing is there. I'm clicking on active now, meaning active translation. Now that I've clicked here, I'm ready to upload my source text. Okay, but make sure that you're here, not in glossaries. We don't want any more glossaries. Click on active as translation and click on upload. And here is where we will need to decide source text, source language, blah, blah, blah. So what would you like to translate? Look, these are the file formats we can upload into this tool. Web pages, Word files, plain text. Is it a complete list of file formats? No. Okay? It's kind of okay. For example, you know, if you're translating... This I have to move, I think. For example, yeah, if you're translating apps for iOS environment, this is the source file you will get as a translator. If you're translating for Android operating system, they don't show and they don't offer the possibility, you will be working with XML. So there will be a limitation for this. It's just true. So you have an overview of the format. Click on Add Content to Translate, and this will be the way we import the source text. Upload file, choose file, please go for the source text that we have in exercise 4. Okay. Make sure that that we set English as source language from here. And then as target, remember that, for example, I uploaded the glossary in Slovenian, so I need to specify Slovenian as target language. Start typing your language and it will show there. It's not Slovak, it's Slovenian. So click on that one. Here is where I decide my target language. Czech people should write Czech here, or Serbian, any language in it. Are we fine here? Okay, click on next. And remember, we are giving our source text to Google, and any edits that we make on the text will be used for them to improve their empty engines. We should be happy, or we should be sad. Actually, we should be happy if this helps to improve your system, and I'm not delivering or I'm not uploading confidential data, for example, in the context of training translators, why not? They offer you the possibility, as it was the case with Midcat. Maybe you're not a professional translator. Do you want a professional translator to work on your text? We will go here. We assume that we are the professional ones here, so forget about this and we say, no, thanks. I'm going to work post-editing my own text. Okay, so here we have now the source text uploaded. Okay, so click on the text. Let me see that close. If you've opened it, don't worry, it's fine. Something that I haven't checked, because it was too fast. Let me see. I wanted to make sure. I'm actually going to do it like this. If you haven't done it, don't worry, I'll do it now. And look at the screen. We've uploaded the glossary, we didn't tell explicitly, because it has to be done from here in the tools, that we need to take into account our glossary for this particular text. We didn't do it. Look here. I'm going to do it now. Click on Tools, and I could select my own private translation memory, or I can work with the shared one across all people using Google Translator Toolkit, and here, which probably you didn't do, but don't worry, look at the screen. Pick a glossary. Here is where I'm going to say that glossary that I uploaded in CSV should be taken into account during the post-editing process. And mine was called Microsoft Glossary Slovenian, so I click on it, and I click on Next. That part was missing. So probably you won't see the terms, I will see the terms. But don't worry, that was just to show. No thanks, we don't want professional people looking into my text and my own professional source text. And this is how it looks in Workbench. Now you've seen three. A little bit different from MailCard, a little bit different from SDL Online Translation Editor. Again, we work at the segment level. And for example, Martin was saying, any special functionalities, knowing that post editors do a lot of copy-paste, the same as you will find in any other translator workbench. Okay, so we will work at the segment level, and we post edit, we click on here. We post edit, we click on here, or we press Control J. Maybe you don't want to remember this, because normally in all the tools is Control Enter. In the case of this particular tool, you translate approved segments on clicking on Control J, in case you want to remember. Do you see any glossaries here on the screen? No. Why? Because I need to click on Show Toolkit. Click on Show Toolkit. And if it doesn't show for you, remember, it's because I went back and I, in the process of uploading the text, I click on Tools, select Glossary. Can you see that all those terms that I had in that CSV file are here? Okay, for me they show. Very important, and this is the, we are reaching the final part of the exercise. In this case, the empty output that I get from Google matches my glossary. But it could be the case that the terminology that I get in my glossary doesn't match the empty output. And you need to know that in the case of Google Translator Toolkit, this glossary is not changing the output anyhow. It's your job as a professional translator to check that the output that you get matches the glossary. This is not done by them. Okay? So it's useful to an extent. Make sure that for overview into Slovenia, you use this term, which happens to be the same probably because it's one-to-one relationship, I don't know, or correspondence. But if it wasn't, it's your job to look here and write there, the right equivalent. Okay? Yes.
When does the translation memory come into play? I mean, does it use it for exact matches or also for fuzzy matches, but then we would have to specify a threshold, or how does this integrate here?
This is integrated in Google Doc. Actually, if it's integrated, it shows here in the same way. Mm-hmm. Okay, now when I was uploading my text,
so on the right-hand side, you see basically the Google machine translation output, and down below you would additionally see fuzzy matches.
Fuzzy matches.
By default, can you specify a threshold?
Then you can specify a threshold. By default, you will work with 75%.
Okay.
Let me show you again where to do this, because we were not supposed to work on this thing. It was just to let you know that glossaries are shown here. Remember to click on Show Toolkit. And it's your job to check and change if it's necessary. Just to wrap up with Martin's question, I'm gonna save and close the text. Let me go back here. And if I wanted to upload a new text, in Tools here is where I select the translation memory and I can work with different options. Glossary, the glossary here, translation memory here.
Yeah.
It's not going to be as advanced as professional tool, but they give you the possibility to create your translation memory as well. Okay? People, leave it there. And remember, glossaries are an option there, but they don't influence the empty output. Very different from this tool I'm showing now in exercise 5. That you only have to look at the screen, you don't have to do anything, just to make sure that we correct it. Google Translator Toolkit, glossary support, but no influence in empty output. Look at this.
I got different suggestions from computer translation down in the right corner, and different fuzzy matches from translation memory.
Did you work with this tool before?
Yes, but I used another account, so it shouldn't be influenced by my work before.
If you have translation memory matches, it's because at some point you have the translation memory activated there. Or maybe make sure that, for example, yeah, but it should complain. Glossaries can only be imported as CSV files, so you, hopefully you never...
When you work in this tool, you have, and you have translation memory, so you have suggestion in the field from translation memory, if it is.
If it is.
If it's not, if there is nothing in translation memory, usually it's copied English text. And you have, in the right corner, in front, you say computer translation. And you have the suggestion from computer translation, and you can use it by clicking use suggestion, and then edit it in the field upstairs. Now I have different, I have a match here.
Is it a long segment? Or, for example, here, remember that the segment is almost just one.
It's a segment, it says Fregle.
Fregle, like here. And here you see also translation memory matches, you see?
And it's different.
That we have to assume that at some point you've been working with the tool and the TM is connected there. Because the rest, do you see any translation matches there? Apart from the glossary correspondent? Because since we haven't like, specified any TM, and I'm assuming that maybe you didn't upload any TMs before recently for the same account, this should be the thing to expect. Keep your browser open and we have a look later. Okay? Let me show you that other option in exercise 5. You only have to look at the screen. Okay? There is this other tool, again, linked to SDL products, people with travel and so on, where they give us the possibility to upload our glossary with the aim of influencing or changing the empty output that we get from them. Meaning that the empty outputs that they will deliver, which will be from SDL language cloud empty engines, nothing to do with Google and so on, will be affected by my glossary. Okay, so let me show you. Here you just have to look. And I'm going to this web page here, which actually is the same page that we went, but for that, it's true that I have an account, professional, where I can do that because at some point I paid for that. You won't be able to do that with the account we created in exercise 3. But just have a look here, because I think it's useful to know. We didn't have the time to work long enough in a text, so you can complain about, this is very repetitive, I'm changing over and over the same mistakes. But this is generally the case in many post-editing tasks. Okay? So, for example, also a question that we got from the colleagues over there. If the terminology is wrong, how can I go about it? And I say, very simple, we could make search and replace, and of course have a look at everything again. But with this tool here, you will see that I can influence. Let me log in. Remember, you cannot do this with your free account, but look here. I'm going to this icon here, which is translation. And this looks like an empty engine, of course, from SDL Travelers. Okay, here I will be able to copy paste text, or I will be able to work with files. Okay. Can you see that they also give me an option before I upload files for any of these languages, most of the languages here, that I can add a term base, similar to adding a glossary in the previous exercise. Okay? So I don't have any of those. So first, just to show you that the empty output changes, I don't want to specify any glossary. I'm going to choose a text, the one for exercise 5. Actually, I didn't put you any text. It could be the same from the previous exercise. This one, source text, open. And I'm going to run it from English into Slovenia. You can see that they offer also Croatian. Most of the languages are there. And remember, it's SDL empty engines. I've selected it here, and I'm going to click on translate. It's thinking. the files are available for download and blah blah blah. But actually, now I know why I didn't put the source text. Let's do it so I don't have to upload, download. I'm gonna paste the text here, a chunk of text. It's good that you see that from here you upload files, or from here you just paste text. It detected English, Slovenian, translate. It's just that I want you to look here. English source, target into Slovenian. No influence from my own glossary because I don't have any glossaries there. Okay? Try to remember, or let's just keep it there, or you will have to believe me that in the case STL terminology doesn't match the glossary, the second part of the exercise will change the output because they will take into account my own terms in here. For example, what is in Slovenian Dadotek? Ododatek. And a document at in. Yeah, at in is the document.
Yeah.
That I think they have already learned because at some point I think they had this equivalent. At, maybe it was a different language.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but remember, first part, no term base, so no influence in their output. Let me show you now that if I go here to my panel, I have the possibility of using one out of five term bases. Let me upload the glossary. I don't have any term base, but I'll create a new one. Slovenian term base. Next, it's going to be English and Slovenian. That's what we have in those files. To import. Okay, this is my translation, sorry, my database, my terminology database within this tool, but now it's empty, right? They know the languages, but there are no terms there. Let me import the file. And this I want to do. Can I do it here? Choose a file, and remember they accept all those files. Let's go for the short so it doesn't take long. CSV file. Exercise 5. I don't think I have it here. Sorry, it was the exercise. I didn't put it there. Let me take it from this one. I will put clear information on the files again. So now that terminology database has some content, of course. Your import has been successful. Queue for execution. Hopefully it doesn't take a lot. But now you know that as part of this workbench, I'm providing terminology equivalents, right? That they were in that CSV file with terminology from Microsoft. Going back to my translation dashboard, now you can see that I can influence the output of the empty engine if they take into account my glossary. Different from what we've seen in Google Translator Toolkit. They showed me equivalence, but it didn't change the empty output. Now, hopefully something changes if the equivalents are different, but if I select, before I press translate, my own glossary, they will be in the output. So I'm saving a lot of time of repetitive work if the terminology was wrong. Okay, so here make sure that you select the right equivalent, and let's just try to remember first sentence, if you can read it, but otherwise, yeah. Believe me that it takes into account the terminology. Okay, can you spot any changes? I can tell you the terms that we have there. That should be the, that was already right.
This is check.
This is check, right? Good point. That was a little bit. Adotec was already there, but I don't know if you remember any other. They should follow this in the DM. Okay, so do we get the idea here? Mm-hmm. Comparing Google Translator Toolkit against this tool, of course we go for this one. Because we are able to influence the terminology output in a nice way, so we save repetitive work, changing terminology.
Let me try to understand this. To what extent does it handle like plural forms and so on?
Didn't happen last.
Just only one to one. So yes. If it's an exact match of the word footer that occurs, then it will be noga in Slovenian. Nothing else. No handling of any infected words.
Nothing. Good question. Actually, as we saw also in Milcat, they were like one-to-one correspondence. When we get into plurals, inflected forms and so on, there is a lot of work to do there because they are not able to,
okay,
to do that yet.
But I'm wondering, because SDL normally does have fuzzy matching with terminology. If you use multi-term,
yeah,
it does
but
have fuzzy matching.
This, they do it when we are working with translation memories. In the part or in the module where we influence machine translation, I don't think they have that advanced yet. Yeah, normally yes. There is work to be done there for sure. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure that, you know, we are not giving them probably the right output, but already we are saving something if the inflected form is wrong or something like that. But yeah, they should keep on working. And hopefully, you know, computational linguists, that would be also a field for you. Okay? Make glossaries more friendly in terms of inflected languages and so on. So they are recognized. Yeah, it's true that in the commercial version, they work with multi-term, they work with fuzzy matches for terminologies. But all these options we see for free and so on, it's one-to-one, and I change one character, and then it's
competitive.
Yes, more or less? Okay. Remember, go back home, play with it, same questions. Let's go to exercise six very fast, because it's also a bridge between Martin's introduction to Gross Course yesterday and Pella's presentation today. Open the folder for exercise six, and I want you to open one of the PDF files for your language. Translate Slovenian system, or translate Czech Slovenian system, or translate Croatian system. What do you find there? Here, and now I'm going to show you a presentation here. What I did was, I want you to realize that human translators, of course, are the perfect profile or the perfect people to post edit. Okay? There is this tool here on the internet, in the same way that you've been creating your empty engines with tilde or let's empty, Microsoft Translator Hub will also offer you the possibility to train your own empty engines. Training empty engines, this is the workflow that human translators should understand, right? We have source text, we have target text, and we use this information to create a translation model, parallel data, all of this is recapping on Martin's presentation. We have a language model, monolingual corpus, used to fine-tune, or to adjust. And of course, then we get some outputs. Can you see a face here? Human translators? Human translators, we've been doing stuff here at the end of the process. Engineers, computational linguists, they work here, and then they call us as humans at the end to post-edit. Is this the case forever and ever? No. I want you to make sure that, or I want you to be positive about the idea of human translators should also work here in the translation body, providing quality bilingual data. And also in the process of evaluating the system so they can retrain the system over and over again. How do we do that? How do we take human translators to provide feedback whether a system is ready to be deployed or not? That's what you see on those PDFs that I put there. I trained the system using the MEA corpus, Okay. And I think it was in this case, I can actually show you. Let me go into this so you actually see. You will go to this web page, you will want to build your translation system. I created the account that I used to train those three systems. And here you will see my three systems. And they give me blue scores here. It was just for fun. I mean, of course, I would get better data, more quantity, blah, blah, blah. But you can see that the Slovenian has a blue score of 42. Do you remember Martin's guidelines? Is this supposed to be kind of okay system?
Yeah.
I mean, kind of okay, 30 going 50, we are happy, but of course, it's going to get more. But just by looking at these numbers, which system is going to give you worse output? The Croatian. Mm-hmm. The lower the blue score is, the worse it will get in terms of quality of the output. And then Spela will explain more later. Okay? Just open the PDF, and this is what you will get from that Microsoft Translator Hub. Before we click on deploy system, meaning be able to use the system, play with it, post it, and so on, they offer you the possibility to evaluate the results. Okay, all the steps that you need to follow to build the system, and I can show you here. This is the system that I, for example, for Croatian it's very bad, but you can see that I was using nothing. Okay, it was just for fun, so just train the system, evaluate results, request deployment, meaning make it live. Okay, at this point you get those tables that I sent you. And it's also a nice way for human translators. For example, yesterday Marty was showing numbers, or diagrams, triagrams, blah, blah, blah. How will we evaluate this? Translators, we are not very good at numbers, but we are good at knowing red. Error. So, what are you having here? Source segment, reference translation, and the empty output that I get from that system. Okay, and of course you can see that blue and green match, that will give higher blue scores, and red sequences that they cannot find in the reference translation. Okay. I cannot give you more information on whether they have in mind like bigrams, trigrams, and so on. But that would be a good way, you know, just to spot. Okay, you give me that blue score that was on top of the PDF file. Remember that blue score is automatic. Let's see if it correlates with human evaluation. You will use these tables. Right then, yeah, ready to deploy. This is kind of high, and I'm kind of happy with the output, thinking of it's worth to offer posterity workflows. We press deploy system, meaning make it live. If we are not happy with the, for example, the Croatian team, very blue score, rather low, we will see that you are not happy with the reference translations and the output, comparing and so on. So we will need to train more data. Okay, feed more data into the system, bilingual data, and hopefully we improve the blue score. Okay? So the aim of this exercise was basically to let you know that as a human translator, sometimes you might be requested to work in the empty industry, not only to post edit at the end, always, or there is also the possibility to give feedback before they deploy the system. Based on your human criteria to evaluate the raw empty output. Are we asked to post edit here? To change anything? No. We're just asked to look and make a final assessment of this is kind of true or there is a mismatch between you telling me that this is rather good, but what I see here is not. Okay? That would be a way to look into it. For example, Martin said yesterday that it would be good, so it would be kind of interesting to find a system where the blue scores are high, but that doesn't correlate with human. because in principle, Hebrew scores should correlate with human evaluation. That's the whole point of it. Yes? Cool. Let's just keep on running. I know that I have to be fast. Exercise 7, crowding. Crowding is very important for those who want to work as a professional translator, because it's going to give you a platform for working in many, many projects from the localization world. Apps, websites, anything. Everybody created an account, right? So just click in the direct link here. And this morning, before we started, I asked you to log in. Okay. Log in. And here you will find a notification asking you to join the project that I invite you to. Okay, are we all there? You say yes, and I can confirm that in the settings of this project called TransTech, I'm in the settings and I see all these translators. Perfect. Is anyone pending? Yes, Daniel Pro didn't accept the invitation yet. Martin, Spella. Okay, you need to go into your crowding account. Crowding.com.
Finally, we are monitored here.
Go to Crowding, login. And here at the top right corner, accept the invitation if you want to work in the files. Otherwise, no problem. You don't need to work. For the ones who accepted the invitation, let me show you again another post-editing workbench. Click on the name of the project, TransTech 17, and you've seen, or you can see that this is a project with all these languages. We have all the languages in the class: Croatian, Czech, French, German, Slovenian, Spanish, and also Serbian, which shows below. Okay? And you can see that here, all these languages, it says, the files that you have in this project, they are already translated, but they need to be validated. Translated by whom? By machine translation. Okay? That's one of the possible workflows. I go here to my Spanish, and one of the scenarios will be, they invite me to the project, and they don't pre-translate texts with any kind of machine translation or translation memories. All of these, the percentage of the file will be 0%, and then I translate from scratch. It doesn't mean that below I will be able to check empty if I want to use it or translation memory matches. Here you will see that from the beginning, because I think, or I thought as a translation, as a project manager, that it would be useful for you, I've already pre-translated all the text with machine translation. And this is why it shows 100% translated. Okay? Let's just do one of the files.
So you know which machine translation system you use?
Yes. I can give you here the information that we have. For example, for machine translation, they always offer by default a Microsoft translator.
Okay.
And on top of that, they always, it always shows below, but you cannot pre-translate unless you have an APK. The machine translation that I use for pre-translating was Yandex. And here, this is how I plug in the API. So you will see now when you open the files that each segment shows machine translation from Yandex, and below, they also show you Microsoft translation. But that, I didn't use it for pre-translation because I don't have the API. Actually, that system that I showed you in Microsoft Translator Hub, the one with a blue score of 42, could be plugged here. If I press deployment and then I get the API. So
the API usually means you have to pay.
The API, for example, good question. API means that you need to pay after a certain amount of characters. For example, if I'm for academic purposes, I don't need a million characters probably. So I can still, they will want my credit card from the beginning, that's true. I need to enter my credit card. But they won't charge me anything unless I go beyond, let's say, 1 million, in Microsoft it's 2 million characters for free. But I didn't dare to enter my my credit card there. But that would be the way to get this link, to paste it there, so I can pre-translate also. Let me show you one of the files. We don't need to go over all of them. And you see that in the platform, everybody can see a folder called App Android Files, App iOS Files, Marketing, Full Post Editing, Website, Live Post Editing, etc. This is within the project, once that you click. Do you all see this? Okay, so let's just, for the sake of demonstration, let's go for our website example. And can you open that file, that folder, sorry, website, and go to a subfolder called file 2, called login. Do we all see 25 files there?
Yeah.
Okay, so the idea is that normally I will upload just one file because I'm expecting just one person working on the file and then a second person approving. Here, since we are working in parallel, I want everyone to have their own source text. Okay, so you're going to be file 1, if you want, file 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, if you want to translate, 16. That's the file you need to open, so you don't influence on the other one.
In the marketing folder?
In the website folder, subfolder file 2. Remember that number that I give you. I'm going to be 22. Yes? Did you manage to open this?
Yes.
Right. Don't worry about this empty string. Go for the first one, should be login. And everybody should find already a translation there. Very bad one in the case of time, by the way. Okay, login. Matt, you know that it looks a little bit different from what we've seen so far. Normally we have like a double column, source to the left, translation to the right. Here we work, again, at the segment level, but source is shown here, and target is shown here. This is the pre-translated text from machine translation, and I can tell you that this is Yandex. And if you look below, can you see these green icons here? Mm-hmm. This is translation memory matches coming from common projects within the platform. And for example, I know that machine translation is wrong, but this translation match is 100% match, and this is what I want for my Spanish. It's a translation memory match. If you go below this, you go below, for example, you see again Yandex translation and machine translation from Microsoft Translator, which happens to have the right equivalent, by the way, for my language. Yeah, the important thing here, go down, and all of these are translation matches, translation memory matches, wrong, coming from the global TM that you share in Crowley. And this is Yandex machine translation, Microsoft machine translation. The one you find up there is always going to be Yandex, as I told you. Okay? How many of you need to have to change login? For Croatian was wrong, for Serbian was wrong, for Spanish was wrong, for French was wrong. Okay, did you find the right equivalent in the translation memory?
No.
Yeah. No, for your first Serbian, probably there are not enough Serbian people working with crowding yet. That would be a reason why you don't get in a public project, of course. This is used by companies and they close their projects. Nobody sees their translation memories or anything. It's just like here I'm sharing, you know, the translation memory. The way to go about it, for example, here, I know that I'm going to be faster. Clicking on Iniciar Sesión, save. And then I jump to the next segment, and then we work at the segment level.
Why are the translations displayed there?
Because in Crowley, no matter what, it could be a web page, it could be everything, we always work like this.
Okay, but
at the segment level.
It would be better overview if you saw at least which strings you had already translated?
Yeah, that happens, for example. Good question. If we go back to login, everything is green because everything is pre-translated.
Yeah.
You might know that you have, you know, done your job. For example, I don't know if I give you right, but you approved the translation. For example, this is machine translation. This is the right one. My second phase, I will click here so I approve the translation. And here you will see that it shows different, and I know that this is done. This is human quality already. And this is still translated.
Ah, so I have to approve it.
You need to approve it. Here. Okay, let me show you the real web page behind. This is a web page. Let me show you the real one, or the one that we have. That web page that you're translating there, this is not the one. That login string that you've seen belongs to this page here. That it's showing in Spanish for me because they already have it in Spanish, but let me show you in a different browser. We will never see, actually there is an integration, but let's assume that we don't see nice web pages whenever we translate or we post anything in Crowdly. Always is string, string, string. But that login was this string here. Probably the was the next segment for you in Crowdly. Sign up? Something like that? Hands up. It's this one here. We know it's a title. If the engineer did a good job, since they know that we are not going to see nice things in this head up, they should tell us, be careful, this is a header. Translator should read always the key string, the key information of the string. So they know this is a header, or they know this is a button. Here, this one. This is the one which is up here. BTN. There should be a little bit more explicit, but the engineer is telling me, translate this login as a button. I don't know in your languages, we translate different forms, if it's a heading or it's a button. Okay? So I know it's super fast, but get the idea, you have the account, work at home and send me questions. Okay?
One more question.
Yes.
If I do my own translation,
yes.
So if I don't accept any suggestion, I cannot vote for it and I cannot confirm it. So it's still.
You're telling me that you wrote two heads up.
Yeah.
I don't like this one.
Yeah.
And then I put attention.
Yeah, and then say save.
And then I save. I save anyway.
Yeah.
And then I should be able to approve my one. Probably it's because I did the rest of the people here. Are you able? Yeah. Do you see the voting?
No. I cannot. For my own, I cannot approve it.
This is because from the setting parts, I should give you rights to approve stuff. Yeah. This is just that when you send me the invitation, I invite you to this project, and I have the right to give you translation rights. Approving rights, voting, blah blah blah, but I didn't do that.
So okay. We're still in the lowest branch in the pyramid.
I just want you to clean, but
I'm not
giving you the right to approve.
We are slaves to Barto.
Okay, but it depends on me. Yeah, I have to give you rights to be translator, proofreader, and then you, it's true that we.
This is good.
So, have a look at. Probably, and there are many projects there. I was hoping to have more time, but for example, useful for you, if you're a human translator. Let me just say what we have there, and then you will have a look at home. If you're interested in knowing what is expected from you when you translate apps for Android, have a look at this folder. Strings in XML format. And here, for example, I have an example of, we have an app for tracking sports. You click play, you go running, and while you run, you get audio feedback. It tells you the distance, it gives you the pace, how many kilometers in 1 minute, and so on. All of that is localized into many languages. How do I localize the whatever we hear while we are running? Just a sample. We localize here, hello, this is a test. This is what the user hears when presses the button, test the audio coach. You provide your translation here. These are variables. 1 kilometer in 3 minutes. We actually we only need to translate the preposition there. But you need to be aware, they should give you information here in the context, information telling you this is in, meaning, I didn't write it here, but I will write it for the translators. This is the way you want to translate the preposition in when you're saying 1 kilometer in 5 minutes. If they don't give me this information in German, in French, I wouldn't be sure how to translate in. In as in inside, in as in time, in as... So this is why it's important always to give translator a lot of information here. Okay? And actually, this was a case for saying, we're doing machine translation here, but in this particular file, which is going to be heard through speech synthesis, people are running, people are, you know, cycling, and after some time they hear this information, your paces, this will be a case where we want to sound more human. Okay, we don't want, there is no space limitation, for instance. When we localize apps, this is avatar, and we only have 14 characters. Here, it's for audio feedback. So here we could be as creative as we wanted, because there is no limitation space, and this is going to be heard. So actually, maybe we want to sound nice and polite and blah, blah, blah. So even when it's a posterity task, here there will be a case for being creative within a posterity task. Okay? Do we agree on that? Go home and have a look. I was going to show you that, but it's fine. Another example. And now it's, yeah, we should be going, right? Yeah. Just one more example. If you're interested in how do we localize, for example, for Apple Watch. Apple Watch, do we have character limit there? Of course, screen, very small, there is nothing to work there. How do we localize as a professional translator? Stuff for Apple Watch. It's going to be a file with strings. And, for example, this will be something ready for the translator. Translate average pace. But they're telling me you cannot use in your language more than 7 characters. Oh. Why? Because this is how it shows in Apple Watch. It has to fit here. Uh-huh. Okay? So make sure, even when you're posterity, you cannot provide translation longer than 7 characters. Otherwise, it will cut.
Impossible.
And so this is included inside, and it will check if the string is.
It won't let you. Very good question. It won't let you save. For example, I prepare this in a way. For example, if I don't read this because I'm not a professional translator, and I say no, I need to write this. It has to be long because in Slovenian this cannot be shorter. I shouldn't be able to save. They won't let me save because that translation is useless. This has to fit in 7.
Can you preview, for example, this can? No.
This is not preview. No, this is just a screenshot. Yeah. But you should be able to make sense out of. If I write longer translations, first I won't be able to save, and second it won't show.
Okay.
Because then they just cut automatically and things don't make much sense. Okay.
But it's excellent that there is a preview. I mean, many times you have to localize things
without knowing. But this is my job as a localization coordinator, preparing the project. I know what's missing. I know what they need. I know that as much information makes the whole quality better. So I provide as much information as possible.
So Under Armour is the only...
Yeah, people working for it. Yeah, sometimes you know things are not done the right way, but they should be a good way.
If you can, go work for Bart.
Yeah, let's see. Okay, let's leave it here. So we are all kind of hungry, and then we come back with Spella, and at the end, make questions, and I will look into your translation memory. Is it okay? Okay. I know it was fast. Don't worry. Work at home, send me many, many questions, okay? Cool, we'll leave it here.
You want to give your feedback? I'm scared.
You're scared.
If we have to migrate to this, because from a desktop application, and then you move to something like this, where you have very little control of what's going on in the back end,
it's correct. Very good comment. Actually, I was not going to tell you, but in the background, I can create reports on your productivity. Let me show you here.
This is something we are not going to tell our masters.
in the settings, I can create reports. You won't do, you won't be able to do that because you don't have the. But here, I will know that the user X. I will click here on. It doesn't show a lot because we didn't work actually. But for example, here. The thing is that we haven't been working. But here you see graphs on how productive they are. On how, also how much machine translation they use. How much translation memory matches they use. So that's true that this is a bit broader engine for selecting the more productive ones. So be ready for it. Yeah. For example, can you see, very silly, just to say words translated. Words translated by TM. Words translated by EMT. Am I able to control how much empty you use? Of course I am. Am I able to control how much use you take from translation memories? Yes. We have nothing, we didn't work, but it should be like very representative of each of you working. Okay? Let's go and have lunch.